assembly and all living beings. Please turn the wonderful Dharma wheel to teach us how to leave suffering and attain bliss and end birth and death and quickly realize that birth.
Namo Sadanto Suche Doye Alaihadi Samyao Samputoshe.
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 Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yan Jing Hua Yan Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa.
Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yan Jing Hua Yan Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa.
Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yan Jing Hua Yan Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa.
Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yan Jing Hua Yan Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa. Homage to the Buddha's Flower Garden Sutra of Great Expansive Teachings. Homage to the Buddha's Flower Garden Sutra of Great Expansive Teachings and the Ocean-Wide Flower Garden Assembly of Buddhas and Bodhisattvas.
And the Ocean-Wide Flower Garden Assembly of Buddhas and Bodhisattvas.
Wu Sang Sheng Sheng Wei Miao Fa Bai Qian Wan Jie Nan Zhao Yu Wo Jin Jian Wen De Shou Chi.
The unsurpassed, deep, profound, subtle, wonderful Dharma and 100,000 million eons is difficult to encounter. Now that I've come to receive and hold it within my sight and hearing, I vow to fathom the thus come one's true and actual meaning.
上人,各位法师,还有各位佛友,大家阿弥陀佛。今天是2014年4月19日,星期六的晚上,现在我们是在加州伯克莱圣寺。今天晚上我们所要研究的是大方广佛华严经的十地品,现在我们到了第五地,南圣地。Venerable
Master, Dharma Masters, all Dharma friends, tonight is April 19th, 2014. It's a Saturday, and here we are at Berkeley Buddhist Monastery. We're invested in the Avatamsaka Sutra, and we're on the 10 grounds chapter in the Avatamsaka Sutra, and we're on the fifth ground, the ground of difficult conquest.
这个华严经呢,它的义理非常的深奥,而且是很究竟的道理。那在翻译出来的经文也,文词呢,非常... 优美,所以呢,我们可以多读一点经文,把这个华严经的经文呢,种在我们的第八识里头,跟华严经呢结了更深更深的缘,以后呢,生生世世都可以再遇到华严经。So
the teachings of the Avatamsaka Sutra are especially profound and deep. The words that is used to write it out also is extremely elegant. And so for us to be able to study it and create affinities with it is a very precious opportunity. Then life after life, we will always be able to study this sutra and be near this sutra.
现在我们是中文本在第56页,所以我们把56页呢,这整页都来读一遍。
So we're on page 56 in the Chinese. So, and it's 57 in the English. So we'll read the entire page 56 together.
积极福至圣功德。
精勤方便观上帝。
佛力所加具念会。 了知四谛皆如实，
了知四谛皆如实，
善知四谛胜异谛，
善知四谛胜异谛，
向谛痴别成立谛，
向谛痴别成立谛，
四谛生尽即道谛，
圣谛生尽即道谛，
乃至如来无碍谛，
乃至如来无碍谛，
如是观谛虽微妙，为得无碍胜解脱，
为得无碍胜解脱，
以此能生大功德，
以此能生大功德，
是故超过四智慧，
是故超过四智慧，
既观地以知有为，
既观地以知有为，
体性虚伪无坚实，
体性虚伪无坚实，
得佛持名光明分，为利众生求佛智，
为利众生求佛智，
观诸有为先后际，
观诸有为先后际，
无明黑暗爱残浮，
无明黑暗爱残浮，
流转迟回苦聚中，
流转迟回苦聚中，
无我无人无寿命。
So we can read the English together. He amasses blessings and wisdom, supreme merit and virtue. With vigor, diligence, and expedience, he contemplates the superior ground. Sustained through the Buddha's power, he is endowed with mindfulness and wisdom, so he completely understands the four truths as they really are. He well knows worldly truth and truth in the supreme sense, the truth of marks and truth of discriminations and establishments. Phenomenal truth, truth of productions, exhaustion, and the way, up to the thus come one's truth of non-obstruction. Although such contemplations of the truth are subtle and wonderful, he has not yet attained unobstructed supreme liberation. Yet using these, he is able to produce great merit and virtue, and so they far surpass any worldly wisdom. Since he has contemplated the truth, he knows that the condition is in substance and nature false, without solid actuality. He obtains a share of the Buddha's light of kindness and sympathy, and to benefit living beings, he seeks the Buddha's wisdom. He observes all conditioned dharmas which are bounded by before and afterwards, as shackled by the fetters of love and the darkness of ignorance. They haphazardly revolve in the mass of suffering. He sees them as devoid of self, of others, and of lifespans.
现在我们是在十地品第五地南圣地，那么这第五地最后寄送的部分，第一首寄送讲的是叫积极福至圣功德，精勤方便观上帝，佛力所加具念慧。了知四谛皆如实，那这首偈颂呢、有很多深奥的道理在里面，我们、可以慢慢来、研究这些道理。第一句叫积极福至圣功德，就是我们要呢、累积，然后呢来收集福至，就是福德跟智慧这种殊胜的功德。那么这个福德跟智慧既然要积极，表示呢我们要、很努力的来修行才会有福德跟智慧，所以这个福德智慧呢不是凭空而来的，你不是说我们不修行、不努力那就会有这个福德智慧，或是呢我们、只要求 佛菩萨，佛菩萨呢就会给我们福德跟智慧，那世间上是没有这个道理的。这个福德智慧是要我们自己呢、要努力要来修行，就像在楞严经里头，阿难尊者呢他就跟佛讲说，他以为呢他是佛的这个堂弟，所以呢他有一个做佛的哥哥了，他不需要努力修行、他也可以呢这个开悟啊或怎么样，但是佛就告诉他呢，这个修行呢是个人吃饭个人饱，这个自己生死自己了，不是呢说你 去求别人给你福德，给你智慧，你就会有福德智慧。所以呢，这里寄送就讲到我们要去要积极，就是要累积，然后呢慢慢去把它收集。所以呢，这个释迦牟尼佛呢，他有三大阿僧祇劫，就是在修福跟修慧。
So here, the first verse says, he amasses blessings and wisdom, supreme merit and virtue. With vigor, diligent expedience, he contemplates the superior ground. Sustained through the Buddha's power, he is endowed with mindfulness and wisdom. So he completely understands the four truths as they really are. So this first verse has many, you could say, deep principles in it. So the first line says, he amasses blessings and wisdom, supreme merit and virtue. So here, the Bodhisattva is gathering together or accumulating blessings and wisdom. It shows that these blessings and wisdoms don't just come from nowhere. They come from hard work and cultivation. And it's not something that we can just wait and hope that the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas will just bestow upon us blessings and wisdom. Rather, we have to work hard and cultivate ourselves. For instance, like Ananda, Venerable Ananda in the Sharangama Sutra, he thought that the Buddha would give him wisdom because he was the Buddha's, he thought, favorite cousin. He was a cousin of the Buddha, related to the Buddha. So he thought his cousin, would bestow wisdom upon him. However, the Buddha said, this is not a principle. You have to cultivate yourself to have wisdom. And so there's a saying that's very very popular. It says, only after you eat will you get full. Only your own birth and death can you end it. You have to end your own birth and death. No one else can do it for you. So the Buddha himself had to cultivate for 3 asamkhya kalpas, amassing blessings and wisdoms, before he could finally realize Buddhahood.
佛成佛以后呢，被称为两足尊，那就是他的福修足了，圆满了，这个智慧呢也修足了，圆满了，叫做，所以呢福至两足尊。那我们既然学佛呢，我们也要跟佛一样经过长远的修行呢，来修福跟修慧。如果我们在修行的时候呢，光修福不修慧，那是很危险的，因为很多人呢有福报，那他就会生在人间做一个富贵的人，或是呢生到天上去享天福。天上虽然很快乐，可是呢这个天福享尽了，他福报没了，还是要堕落到这个六道里头，再受轮回。那如果一个修行人、出家人呢，或是要修行的人，他过去生中他不修福德的话，那等到他今生在修行的时候就没有福报了。没有福报呢，就没有人供养。这个出家人呢，因为要修行，所以呢，他不是生产，他不做其他的这些买卖啊，或是去自己做种田、种菜来生活，所以需要靠在家人来供养。那这个供养的时候呢，就需要有四事供养就是衣服、饮食、卧具、汤药，这需要由在家人来供养。那么因为在家人供养出家人呢，所以呢他就在修福。可是如果一个出家人他过去生中没有这个修福德的话，那么今生修行的时候他就不会有这个资粮了。他在修行的时候可能就没有衣服穿，没有食物可以吃，没有房子可以住了，或是呢他没有交通工具，或是生病了，没有医生，没有这个医药可以来治疗，那就受很多这个苦。那这样的话，要修行就很困难。
So the Buddha is said to be one who has perfected both blessings and wisdom. So we often say the Buddha is the doubly perfected one. He has perfected both blessings and wisdom. So we, as Buddhist disciples, want to be like the Buddha. So this can only happen after a long period of cultivation. And after some time, we ourselves can be replete with blessings and wisdom and realize Buddhahood. If one only cultivates blessings, then it is very dangerous. One will, you can say, be very, maybe very wealthy in this life, or will end up going to the heavens. However, after being in the heavens for a period of time, one's blessings are used up, and then one has to will then fall and then undergo suffering again. And so this kind of blessings is not, you can say, ultimate. It's not reliable. So also, if a monastic, someone who has gone forth to become a monastic, has not cultivated both blessings and wisdom in the past, then he will not receive any offerings in this life. He may want to cultivate, but because he has not prepared the groundwork, he has not prepared the foundation for his practice, and has not done any cultivation of blessings, then as he tries to cultivate, he does not have this material support for him to go forward and practice. Because as a monastic, one does not work for a living, does not grow plants and grow their own food. So a monastic has to receive the offerings of lay people, especially the four requisites of food, clothing, shelter, and medicine. And by these offerings, then the monastic can sustain his life. So if the monastic in his past life did not cultivate, then he would have great difficulty in this life, because perhaps he has no clothes to wear, or he has no house to live in, or he has no food to eat, or as he travels, he has no vehicle to travel in. Or perhaps when he's left outside without any home to live in.
所以有一个偈颂说修福不修慧，向生挂璎珞，修慧不修福，罗汉脱空波。意思说，光修福德的话，不修智慧，那么这个来生呢，就变愚痴了，变愚痴，很多人呢，就堕落到畜生道去。
So there's a saying that if one is replete with blessings but not with wisdom, then one is like an elephant with a necklace of precious jewels. If one cultivates wisdom but has no blessings, then one is like an arhat with an empty offering bowl. Now, if we cultivate blessings and don't have any wisdom, this is likened to an elephant one may fall into the animal realms, because one is not very wise, one is kind of foolish. And so one becomes an animal, it goes into the animal realms. But because you have blessings, then you around your neck you have a necklace of precious jewels. And so it might be really beautiful, it might look very nice and very adorned. However, still, the person is in an animal's body. So that is not what we want to do. Or if one just cultivates wisdom and has no blessings, then it's like an arhat who has an empty bowl. Although the arhat has already awakened to a certain level of awakening, he is certified to a certain level of awakening. However, as he goes out on alms round, he receives no offerings. And the reason is because he hasn't cultivated blessings in the past. So we can see from both of these that we don't want to be biased towards any side. We need to cultivate both blessings and wisdom simultaneously as they work together.
在《法华经》第27品《妙庄严王本事品》就有一个大家很熟悉的故事。在这一品里头呢，就讲到妙庄严王他过去生中呢，他是一个修行人，是一个比丘。那个时候呢，有四个比丘他们在一起呢，想要精进的来修行，因此呢，他们就远离了聚落。 住到比较啊这种极静的这种森林里头来修行，因为远离了村庄聚落呢，所以就要托钵乞食的时候就很困难，或是呢啊去即使呢去托钵，但是呢也常常托空钵回来，因为呢在住在很偏远的地方的人都是很穷困的，他自己的生活都有困难，因此呢也没有这个能力来供养啊出家的比丘。因此呢这四个比丘呢他们在修行上就有很多障碍啊，就是没有人供养，那每天要饿肚子的时候呢这个修行呢就修不下去了，因为要身安道隆，这个身体要健康了，那这个修道呢才会啊能够修成功的。因此呢啊在他们很困难的情况之下，这个时候呢有一个比丘他就发了心了，他觉得说如果再继续下去呢，那将来他们四个人可能都要饿死了，那饿死了就不能修行啊，所以呢他愿意来牺牲自己，那么来成就另外三个比丘供养他们，因此呢他就还俗了去做工。那么他把他做苦工辛苦守得赚的钱呢那来买食物供养这另外三个比丘，所以呢这个三个比丘呢他们在修行的时候呢啊这个食物都没有问题了，他们就可以很安心的来办道，因此呢很精进修行呢以后他们都证果了。可是这个在发心来供养其他三个比丘的这个啊另外一个比丘呢，他因为要工作，所以有时候要到城市里面去。有一天呢在城市里头，他看到这个国王的车队出来了，哇，国王车队一出来，在街上呢这个人民百姓啊都在街道两边呢来欢迎他啊，就是而且呢这个很多呢士兵来帮国王开道，那很多呢大臣呢就侍候在国王的左右，这国王呢坐在马车上威风凛凛啊，这个而且呢身上呢穿得非常的庄严，因此呢这个啊还俗呢在工作的比丘呢啊心里就生出了一种羡慕，打了妄想，他说呢如果我也能够像国王这样子，那我有这种大的权势，也有很多的财富，那我如果要供养这个国家所有的出家人，让这个比丘来修行都很容易啊，我就不需要这么辛苦了，因为我要怎么供养，或是我要来造个庙啊，或是做到造个道场来供养这些比丘都是很容易，他就打这个妄想。那么这个妄想呢打了以后呢啊果然在他这一生呢这个死了以后他往生了，因为他往生呢供养了三个比丘，而且这三个比丘都证果了成了圣人了，因此呢这功德的非常大，因此他打这个妄想要做国王的妄想就成功了，他来生呢就变成啊一个国王，这个国王呢就是法华经上的妙庄严王。那因为他做了国王啊，现在他有财富有地位有势力了啊，有这种军队了，有文武百官了，所以他就迷了，他忘记他过去生中是一个出家的比丘。那等到他做国王以后呢，他不信佛了，也不拜佛了，那他信了这个婆罗门教，就是信外道。那所以呢，如果再继续下去的话，那这个国王呢，将来呢就离这个修行越来越远。可是当时呢跟他在一起修行的三个比丘呢，因为他们都证阿罗汉果了，甚至呢以后他们继续修行呢都成为菩萨，因此呢等到他们有这些啊神通以后，他们就用他们的啊这个天眼来观看一下这个以前供养他们的这个啊还俗的比丘现在到底在哪里了。他们一看呢，原来这个比丘呢跑去做国王了，而且做国王呢又堕落了。为什么叫堕落呢？因为他不修行了，他现在信的是婆罗门教。因此呢这三个啊已经这个修行正果的比丘呢，他们现在变成菩萨了，就发啊要来报恩，来度化这个成为国王的妙庄严王。因此呢他们就现了不同的身，一个就变成啊这个国王的夫人叫敬德夫人，另外两个呢就是现成国王的儿子啊，一个叫敬藏，一个叫敬衍，那就是要来度化这个国王。
So this section, also you can look at the Lotus Sutra in chapter 27. I'm guessing people may be familiar with this story, but there's a story of wondrous awakening, wondrous adornment king wondrously adorned. And the story goes like this, that there first were four monks, four bhikshus, and they went to cultivate in the wilderness. However, because they were far away from any real any cities or people, they often, when they went on alms round, weren't able to get any food. Or perhaps the area around them, they were quite poor and didn't have any food to offer. So for them, they often went hungry or they didn't have much food to eat. So in this situation, one of the monks thought to himself, well, this is not a good scene, because they're all of us are going to be becoming very emaciated and having a very difficult time to cultivate. We need a healthy body to cultivate. So he thought, I will sacrifice myself and be turned to lay life and work hard to make offerings to the other three so they can accomplish the way. So that's what he did. He turned to lay life and worked very hard all day long to purchase enough food to support these three other monks. Now, these other three monks also worked very hard in their cultivation and all had a realization of awakening. So they all became sages. So at this point, this layman who used to be a monk had to go to the city sometimes to work. So when he was there one time, he saw the king come through the city. Now the king looked very majestic in the middle of his entourage. He had all the citizens were lining up on two sides of the road to see him. The soldiers were clearing a path for him. His ministers and officials were all around him. He sat very regally in the middle of all of this, and he looked very awe-inspiring. And so this layman who used to be a monk saw the king and had a thought of admiration and thought to himself, wow, this king really has a lot of power and wealth. If I were the king, I could then make offerings to all the monastics in the country and also build monasteries without any problem. I would not have to work so hard to make offerings to monks. So because of this false thought, when it came for him to go off to rebirth, he actually went off to rebirth because of all the merit and virtue he created from making offerings to the other three monks who all realized sagehood. He received a great reward, and so the next life he became a king. Now the name of the king was at that time Wondrously Adorned, King Wondrously Adorned. He had everything. He had, you know, servants, much material wealth, he had the soldiers, he had the king, the officials, etc., etc. He was very, very wealthy. But because of all this wealth and all this prestige, he actually got very deluded. He actually forgot all about his life before being a monk and about cultivation. Rather, he did not have faith in the Dharma, but rather believed in Brahmanism and left cultivation far behind. So the other three monks who had all received arhatship and were on their pathway of becoming bodhisattvas, gained some spiritual abilities. Some opened their heavenly eye to take a look at where their fellow monk who used to be a monk went. When they looked, they saw, oh no, he has become a king, and his name is King Wondrously Adorned, and he has fallen. Why would I say he's fallen? Why did he say he went downhill or deproved? Just because he was no longer cultivating. He had actually started to believe in a completely different religion and stopped cultivation. So because of that, these other monks thought to themselves, we need to make a vow to help our fellow Dharma friend. And so they made a vow to repay his kindness. And so they all took rebirth in his family. One of them became his wife, who became named Pure Virtue, and the other two became his sons in the family. So they all were born into his family.
那么这两个王子呢，他们都是行菩萨道的，而且都有已经有很多神通跟三昧。这个时候呢，有一尊佛叫云莲英树王花智佛正在讲法华经，所以两位王子呢想要去供养这个佛，也要去听法华经，就跟他的母亲就是敬德夫人讲说他们想要去供养佛，同时也去听经。那他的母亲就说，你们应该呢带着你的父亲一同去听，他现在迷了，所以我们要度他。但是这两个王子就说呢，我们父亲现在呢已经信奉外道了，他还不相信佛法，那我们要怎么办呢？他的母亲就说呢，你们要献一些神通给你的父亲看，那你父亲看了你们献的神通，他心里呢一定会变得清净的。所以两位王子呢就永生到虚空中，他们在虚空中呢上身就出水，下身就出火，或是呢上身可以出火，下身可以出水，或是在空中呢可以行走，可以呢躺下来睡觉，就献了种种这种阿罗汉的十八变。那么这个他的父王呢，妙庄严王看了，哇，心里好羡慕，说我的儿子怎么有这么大的神通啊？那两位王子下来了以后呢，就问他们说，你们的师父是谁？那你们是怎么修行的？所以两位王子就告诉他的父亲说呢，我们的师父就是现在在讲法华经的云莲英树王花智佛。那这个妙庄严王呢，这下子呢就说，那我跟你们一起去我需要去见佛了。所以呢他因为见了佛了，那 心里呢就生出了欢喜心，因为看到佛呢那个相好庄严啊，所以呢妙庄严王非常的欢喜。那佛呢就跟大众讲说，你们看到这个妙庄严王的吗？他呢会跟我出家的，而且呢他出家以后呢他将来要成佛。你看这个妙庄严王呢这么有善根，因为他过去生中就是一个比丘，可是因为他修福啊，所以呢他就做了国王，可是他又因为过去生中也修行修慧，所以这一生呢又遇到佛了，然后遇到他三位同修道友来度化他，因此呢妙庄严王就跟着佛来出家。那在出家以后他非常的精进，以后呢他呢也可以成佛的。所以从这个故事就告诉我们呢，在修行当中呢不能光修福了，因为这修福啊将来一定有大福报。尤其呢这个如果你修福是供养三宝，这供养三宝的这种功德很大的，比你一般在社会上做这些善事的功德还要大。因为供养三宝就是供养十方，供养十方的这种功德是重重无尽的，表示说你呢舍一可以得万报。在地藏经讲得很清楚，就是你供养了一，你将来所得会是万，但是我们不要贪这个功德，那个布施供养这是很自然的事情。因此呢在修行过程中呢一定要福慧福智要同时都修。事实上呢我就发现在伯克莱这个道场呢像今天中午我们吃饭的时候，我知道这个饭菜呢是很多居士他们在家里就做好了，然后带来到道场供养，这就是供养三宝。那供养三宝呢这个功德很大，那个将来的福报也会很大的。所以呢你供养了出家人以后呢，出家人要回报，当然不能讲回报，就是说出家人就要做这个法的布施因为呢居士诚心来供养，因此等到出家人呢用完了斋了以后呢，要对这个在家人来讲法。为什么要讲法？因为这个在家人呢拿了食物来供养，那他就是在修福嘛。修福呢越修这个这种福德呢福报将来越来越大。可是如果他没有修慧，没有听经闻法，这个智慧没有开的话，那将来呢福报大，那也是很危险的。所以呢出家人要做法的布施，要跟他们讲法。
So in this story, they all became reborn in the family of King Wondrously Adorned. So these two princes were both bodhisattvas with great spiritual abilities. And so they wanted to, at that time there was a Buddha named Yun Lei Su Ling Wang, or to say Buddha who existed during that time. And these two princes wanted to make an offering to the Buddha and go listen to the Dharma of this Buddha, who at the time was speaking the Lotus Sutra. Now they thought, let's bring along our father, King Wondrously Adorned, to come and listen to the sutras as well. They spoke to the mother, and their mother said, yes, you should bring your father along. So they said, but however, our father now is a believer in the Brahmanism, an externalist path, and does not have faith in Buddhism. How can we bring him to see the Buddha? The mother said to them, how you could do that is if you manifest your spiritual abilities and impress your father, then you'll have faith and want to study the Dharma. So that's what they did. They flew up into the air and made the 18 transformations of an arahat, which included being able to emit fire from the top of your body, emit water from the bottom of your body, or vice versa, being able to lie down in midair, or be able to levitate into the midair. They manifested all these various abilities. And their father, King Wondrously Adorned, was extremely impressed. He said, how did you learn these things? What did you cultivate to realize these things? So they said, our teacher is the Buddha, and we should all go and study with him. So the king, Wondrously Adorned, also followed along. When he followed along, he met the Buddha. He was extremely happy because he was impressed by the Buddha's hallmarks and fine characteristics, which were all perfect and full. So he then really had admiration towards the Buddha. So you can see he himself also had good roots, because in the past he had made offerings to the triple jewel, to the three jewels, and was a cultivator himself. So the moral of the story is that if we cultivate just blessings, then it can be very dangerous. But however, if we can cultivate the blessings and also offer it to the three jewels, then this will be able to benefit ourselves a great deal. Although we don't want to think about it as benefiting ourselves. But there's a lot of goodness that's created in the world when we make offerings to the triple jewel. Because the making offerings to the triple jewel is making offerings to all the Sangha within the triple jewel of the 10 directions. And so it really is the case, as said in Erstor Sutra, by putting forth one bit of effort, one receives a 10,000-fold response. So it's not to be that we want to be greedy for this, but this is the way things are. So we must cultivate blessings and wisdoms together. We must cultivate them together. Otherwise, we might lack some of the four requisites. For instance, we might lack food, and we might lack various other things. And so for the layperson, one of the greatest things is to make offerings to the three jewels, and this creates a lot of blessings. And for the monastics, are supposed to repay this kindness of the laity and also bestow Dharma and speak some Dharma. This is because, just like today, the lay people, I see, worked very hard to cook today's lunch. I know some people also cooked the food at home and brought it just for lunchtime. So this is an opportunity to make offerings to the three jewels. And it creates a great deal of blessings. However, the responsibility for the monastics is to share the Dharma with the lay people. Because just cultivating blessings isn't sufficient. It actually can be very dangerous. You go to the heavens, but in the end, the heavens' blessings get used up. So what's really important for the monastics is to share the Dharma so that the lay people can grow in the Dharma in the proper way.
在释迦牟尼佛出世的时候呢，当时这个印度那些在家人呢，他们就常常请佛去应供，去供养佛，把他请到家里去，然后呢要准备最好的食物最好的餐具来供养佛跟他的弟子。那佛呢每次应供完了以后呢，一定要升座来为居士们讲法，让他们能够开智慧。那就讲到呢有一个故事，说呢有一次呢，这个佛呢跟他的弟子呢都出去应供了，所以呢在佛的精舍里头呢那时候就只剩下一个沙弥。这个时候呢 也有这个啊另外一个居士要来请佛去应供，还有或是其他的比丘，可是呢这个精舍里头都没有人了，就剩下沙弥。那这个居士呢就说，那既然啊其他的比丘不在，那你就到我家去啊让我供养吧。这个沙弥呢啊很紧张，因为呢他出家不久，没有什么经验，那不过呢也跟着居士到家里去应供了。这个供养啊用完斋呢，就照这个啊佛呢他的这种规矩，就是要做开始呢要讲法，所以呢居士呢就开始请法。那么这居士呢很恭敬的就跪在这个沙弥前面的叩头顶礼，那就要请这个沙弥开始讲法。可是呢这个沙弥呢因为啊还没有经验，他出家呢没有多久，也不知道怎么讲法，就坐在这个啊上面呢啊就很紧张，就开始发抖了，不晓得怎么开口，也不晓得讲什么法。那么这个居士呢以为呢这个啊他不够诚心啊，所以呢就跪在那边的头扣在地上，也不敢抬起来了，就希望沙弥呢要为他讲几句话。这个沙弥就更紧张了，最后呢讲不出来，就赶快跑了。这一跑呢啊这个居士呢啊他叩头在地上呢叩了好久，那么怎么发现都没有啊听到这种讲法的声音呢，所以他就抬起头来看一看，结果发现呢这个沙弥呢不在了。这个时候他看到呢原来那个啊那个座位上人空了。那这个居士呢平常呢他也是学佛有修行的，所以他看到这个法座上啊沙弥不见了，人空了，所以他当时呢就顿悟了，悟到人空啊这种境界。那这时候他很高兴，因为他修行呢现在证得人空了，因此呢心里非常高兴，就呢啊又回到精舍去，要去顶礼这个沙弥，来谢谢他，让他呢讲这个无言之法。他没有开口呢就讲了一个最好的法，让他能够证得人空。那么到精舍呢他去敲门了，这个沙弥又很紧张了，因为他知道他没有讲法就跑回来，现在呢居士一定又要来请他讲法，所以他更不敢开门。那么敲了好久的门，最后呢这个沙弥呢啊一紧张呢，结果怎么样呢啊他也怎么样证得这个法空了，就是他没有法可以讲，但是呢因为在很紧张的状况之下，他自己也证得这个法空了。所以呢你看呢、啊、这种有时候呢在家人来供养出家人呢，那其实也是给出家人机会。像上人就常常鼓励我们要练习讲法，这个练习讲法不只是出家人要讲法，在家人也要讲法，那轮流呢来练习，因为讲法要练习，越练习呢越熟练，那就知道怎么来讲法。那所以这个啊，像居士来供养道场的时候呢，你们啊就是带着食物来供养，然后呢等到大家吃饭或吃完饭的要听法，因为听法呢才会开智慧，同时呢你这个听法呢也是在拥护道场，因为呢你让这个出家人有讲法的机会，他可以练习讲法，出家人练习讲法呢他啊这个将来讲法的技巧就越好，然后能够来弘扬佛法，甚至呢自己的智慧也会啊更能够更深。因此呢这个就是如果你到道场来，不但可以修福也可以修慧，这是啊非常殊胜的一种供养。
So here in terms of Shakyamuni Buddha being in the world, there was a time when a lay people would often invite the Buddha to go for offerings and give offerings to him. And however, there was a time when the Buddha went out for offerings and left only one person in the monastery, who was a young novice monk, a shami. So he lived at the monastery, who stayed there for a little bit, and a layman came, who was very sincere, to request somebody to make an offering of the noon meal. So this novice monk was very new to the monastic life, And so didn't really know what exactly he should do. So he went along with this layman to receive the offering. So he received some very good offerings and was sat on the seat. And the layman very sincerely made offerings to this novice monk. Now after he finished eating, the layman very sincerely knelt before the novice monk to request the Dharma and then started bowing. Now the novice monk was extremely nervous. As a young new monk, he had no idea what to say. So he was getting more nervous and more nervous. And he finally decided, okay, I'm just going to leave. So he ran away back to the monastery. Now this layman was extremely sincere. So he would be bowing and bowing. And after some time, he thought to himself, well, how come there's no sound of the Dharma being spoken? What's going on? So he opened his eye, took a look at the seat. And saw, oh, there's no, the novice monk is no longer there. And as for the moment he took a look at the seat, which was empty, he realized the emptiness of people. He woke up to a certain level of awakening. And so he thought, wow, he himself was a Buddhist and had cultivated quite a lot. And so he woke to the emptiness of people, of living beings. And so he, at this point, said, wow, this Dharma master, this novice monk, is extremely skillful in speaking Dharma. He spoke the wordless Dharma to me. And so he went to go for this novice monk in the monastery. So he went back to the monastery to look for this novice monk. Now this novice monk, of course, was very worried because now this layman was still looking for him. And so outside the door, he was knocking on the monastery door and said, oh no, what am I going to do? He's going to ask me to speak Dharma. I have no idea what to say. So he didn't have anything to say. So he didn't want to open the door. He got very, very, very nervous. He got so nervous that he realized the emptiness of dharmas. So he woke up as well. And so he at that point, you can see how he got so stressed out, he realized the emptiness of dharmas. So here in the monastery, we have an opportunity to speak Dharma after the noon meal. And many people make offerings and also have a chance to listen to the Dharma. And as they listen to the Dharma, it's a chance to one can really develop one's wisdom. But also, it's giving an opportunity for the monks to practice speaking Dharma. This is why the Royal Master often encouraged people, both monastics and laity, to practice speaking Dharma. Because that way, we can all together propagate Buddhism and have it flourish. And also for the speaker, one's able to awaken one's own wisdom and to develop one's ability to speak.
那么在道场除了你用饮食、衣服、卧具、医药来供养出家人是在修福之外，或是你到道场来，像你帮忙扫扫地啊，或是帮忙拜拜啊，把这个拜殿给排好，或是啊帮忙修理一些已经损坏的 这东西啊，比如说帮道场油漆啊，或是电灯坏了，帮他换一换，这都是在修福啊，或是有需要啊，这个有人呢有交通工具了，那法师要出门，你帮他开车，都是修一种修福报的，所以这个福报呢，在道场里头呢是最容易修的。那么在法华经也讲到啊，这个你在道场呢一个小动作就有很大的福报。 法华经有讲到说呢，如果呢，这个道场里头呢正在讲经说法，比如说正在讲法华经，然后有人进来了，这个人从来没有到道场里来，他也不知道怎么来听法，那你看到了，你就去招呼他啊，请他呢坐下来，或是把你的座位呢让给他。那光是这样子一个小动作，就是你看到有人进来拿个经书给他，或是把你的座位让给他，那这个福报有多大呢？ 法华经就告诉我们，那你来生呢，你就可以做刀立天主，你就可以做大梵天王啊，就是这样的一个小小的事情，我们以为呢也不怎么样，不起眼的，可是呢，这样的一个福德呢，啊，就将来可以到天上做天主了。所以呢，可见在道场里头呢，修福呢是最殊胜的，但是修福的同时呢，因为将来福报太大了。 不要像妙庄严王啊！如果你像妙庄严王，以后也去做国王啊，或是做一个世界上最有钱的人，到时候很容易迷的。因为在42章经就告诉我们说：“豪贵学道难 啊，如果你呢是一个有钱很有钱的人，那等到你有钱了以后呢，你要在学道，要在修行，很困难的，因为有钱呢会被这些物质啊财色呢所迷了，你要在修道不容易，因此呢啊这个一定要福慧双修啊，福德跟智慧要并重，否则呢光修福呢以后呢那福报越来越大，但是呢离佛道就越来越远。
So, other than just making the offerings of the four requisites of food, clothing, shelter, and medicine to the monastics, you can also cultivate blessings by doing some work in the monastery. For instance, sweeping the floor, arranging the bowing cushions, fixing maybe some of the broken items in the monastery, like the light bulbs, or something is not in good repair, or perhaps painting, or doing some maintenance work in the monastery. This all cultivates blessings. And it's actually quite easy to do. It's one of the easiest things to do in the monastery. In fact, any little good deed we do in the monastery brings many, many blessings and brings many supreme blessings. And the Lotus Sutra, it gives an example. If somebody were to invite somebody and they're just coming in to listen, and there's a Lotus Sutra lecture going on, then they invite them to join in the lecture or to give them their seat for them to sit down and listen to the Dharma, then because of that, just that small act of goodness, they have planted a seed so that they have the blessings to become the King Brahma, or they can be the king of the Tushita heavens. So just the small acts brings this level of blessings. So this is why in the monastery, to do good deeds is very supreme. However, we need to be mindful not to be like King Wondrously Adorned because and get lost because of our money or wealth or blessings. Or we become the wealthiest person in the world. This is actually not very good and we can get confused easily. In the 42 section sutra, it says, those who have money have a very difficult time cultivating. That's because it becomes very hard to put down all the money and cultivate the way. The money ends up tying a person up. So for us to cultivate bodhisattva blessings and wisdom, one needs to cultivate it together, just as the Buddha did.
我可以讲一个在道场呢修福德的故事给大家听。那这是发生在万佛圣城，而且是很真实的。我们万佛圣城呢，有位居士，那他以前呢住在马来西亚，他是做生意的，他生意呢做得很成功，事实上呢他也赚了很多钱。那等到他赚了钱以后呢，因为他的钱也赚得蛮容易的，可是这些钱呢有一些问题，因为呢这些钱呢大概不是说偷来的，但是呢赚的这种方式上呢，可能需要打点妄语啊，或是要做一些损伤到别人的事情。可是当时呢他没有学佛，所以他不知道。以后呢他学佛了，知道有万佛圣城了，他知道原来他做这个生意呢是很不好的，因为呢损人利己就是别人没有得到好处，但自己得到很多好处所以自己的财产虽然多了，可是将来受果报的时候就很危险，所以他呢这个生意不敢再做了。他呢就下决心说，那我不要做生意了，我应该呢好好现在要修福了，我要将功赎罪，因此呢就决定要全家搬到万佛圣城来修行。那他就在1994年搬到圣城以后呢，他就做全职的义工就是在万佛圣城呢每天就做义工这个做义工很辛苦的，他要每天呢要做很多工的维修那时候你想想看1994年的时候万佛圣城人很少，可是呢要做的事情太多了，一天到晚做不完。那他的同修就是他的太太呢也来做义工，那怎么一做义工呢，他的同修呢就到我们的南校去帮忙做很多事情，所以呢夫妻呢就一起呢到道场来护持道场，也就是在修福了。那他们有两个小孩子，一个是儿子一个是女儿。他儿子呢 到万佛圣城的时候才四岁，很小很小，那么女儿大概只有六岁左右，那就到万佛圣城的玉良小学啊，培德中学，培德中学啊，就这样读书。那么一开始呢，他们到道场呢，因为以前做生意嘛，又赚了一些钱，有些积蓄，所以呢，也没有什么后顾之忧，就是生活呢，他不担心。可是呢，孩子慢慢长大了，你想想看，他四岁的儿子呢，那么他等到十八岁。高中要毕业了，这时候就要上大学啊！上大学，你知道，在美国如果上大学呢，没有奖学金，那这个学费很贵的啊。所以呢，这个等到他儿子呢到十一年级了，他就开始紧张了。这时候他想，如果儿子上大学呢，那将来需要很多学费，那也需要生活费。那现在呢，我们的积蓄呢越来越少了，坐吃山空嘛，就是只花钱，但是已经开始不赚钱了，十几年了，所以这时候他呢有一些紧张了，就开始打妄想。打什么妄想呢？是我现在是不是应该呢自己呢到外面去找个工作啊，去赚点钱啊？不然以后我儿子也要钱，女儿也要钱，家里也要钱，那这个钱从哪里来呢？那如果儿子上大学又需要学费，那怎么办呢？所以呢，他就开始担心呢，也准备想说，是不是暂时不要做义工了去到外面去找个工作来做，那有时间再到道场来帮忙结果呢，他就在那边犹豫不定了，到底要不要？要不要的时候呢，这个时候他的儿子已经到十二年级了，那。十二年级呢，他就开始申请大学。这个儿子是很聪明的我教过，我教他八年那这八年当中，这儿子真的是很聪明的。结果呢，他就在二零零六年这个十二月，他就开始申请大学。那时候呢，有一个很好的大学，就是普林斯顿大学呢，录取了他，而且呢，给他四年的奖学金。那这一下子呢，你想想看，他儿子不用付学费了，那四年都不需要操心了，所以呢，他呢也不需要打那个妄想说要到外面呢去打工去工作了，所以这个时候他又专心呢在道场来做义工，父子道场到现在都还在他的这个同修也一样在学校在帮忙。你看呢，从1994年到现在二十年了，整整二十年。那么他将来扶持道场，虽然呢道场呢没有付钱给他，因为他是做义工嘛，那可是呢在冥冥当中，这个功不唐捐的，他扶持道场，但是呢等到他子女要受教育的时候呢，也得到了回报，就是说他们不需要去操心这个子女的教育问题，而且能够申请到那么好的学校，还可以呢这四年当中他这个不需要去操心他的学费。那事实上他的儿女都很争气的，他们到上大学以后呢，他们都很节俭也不浪费，所以呢这四年当中他的儿子呢虽然去上大学了，但是呢他一毛钱都不要跟他的父母拿，他呢自己呢还去打工，那就是有这个课余的时候呢，他也自己去在学校里就打一点工，赚一点零用钱，所以他们的这个子女的教育或是学费，他们从来没有操心过。我想的就是因为在道场呢，你在护持道场为道场呢来做事的时候，就是在修福。这个修福有时候在直接的时候我们看不到，但是呢很间接的，它就有一个回报。
So I can tell a story about blessings. That's an actual story. So this story actually happened at the City of 10,000 Buddhas. It's a true story about a layman who came to the City of 10,000 Buddhas from Malaysia. He was quite a successful layperson in business, worked in business before, and made quite a lot of money, and was very successful. However, for the money that he made, you can say not all of it was that, you can say, clean or pure. Maybe when he was doing business, he had to tell a couple lies or wasn't 100% honest. Or maybe when he was doing business, you know, took advantage of some people, or maybe he made a lot of money and some other people didn't make as much money. And so it just wasn't the money wasn't just as clean as could be. And so this was before he became a Buddhist. After he became a Buddhist, he realized his mistakes and repented of his actions and wanted to amend it. And so he thought, okay, I'm not going to do this anymore, and I'm going to learn the Dharma. And so he then moved to the city of 10,000 Buddhas in 1994 and became a volunteer worker at the city of 10,000 Buddhas. In the monastery, he worked very hard to help maintain the grounds for everyone. He did a lot of work, and he brought his entire family with him, his wife, as well as two of his children, to be volunteers at the city of 10,000 Buddhas. So his wife would come and work at the boys' school and volunteer, and his two children also went to the schools to study. His two children were, one was 4 years old and one was 6 years old. He had a boy and a girl. So they both went to the boys' and girls' school, and although since he was in business and had quite a lot of financial resources, he had no, problems taking care of his own livelihood while he was volunteering at the city of 10,000 Buddhas. So he was there working for many years. However, as his children grew up, for instance, his son started becoming 16, 17, 18, and became ready to go to college. Now, people know in America that colleges are extremely expensive, and that the cost of educating a kid is not easy. And so the layman thought, well, maybe I need to go out into the world and make some money to be able to support my family. Because if you think about it, after spending so many years in the monastery without actually having any income, although he's not spending a lot, but still there is some outflow of money, then he thought, well, maybe I need to make some money to support my family so my children could go get an education, and also if they need anything. So he started having this false thought. Maybe I should go work outside. However, he was thinking about this for a while, and then his son had already entered senior year of high school. His son was an extremely smart young man. I taught him for 8 years in the boys' school since 2006. And so he applied for various universities. And one of the very good universities, Princeton University, accepted him. And not just that, they offered him a 4-year full scholarship. And so at that point, there was no need to pay for his tuition. So his father had a lot more, did not have to worry about paying for his tuition. And so he stopped having this false thought and could then concentrate again fully on volunteering in the monastery. So he has been there at the monastery since 1994, so that's 20 years now, which is no short period of time. And although in the monastery he doesn't receive any money, he does not get anything, he's just serving without any reward and just doing his best, but things naturally get taken care of. So for instance, his children's education, they generally got taken care of. He didn't have to worry about it. And even then, even his children are actually quite frugal. His son, out in college, basically did not take a dime from his parents, but went off to work on his own to make enough money to cover his own expenses and have a little bit of spending money. So he didn't use any money from his parents. So coming to the monastery to volunteer, one creates many blessings. And although the blessings are invisible, still, they oftentimes have a response.
那我们应该怎么来修智慧呢？ 这个在佛教讲呢， 叫戒定慧， 我们要持戒， 修定， 然后就会有智慧， 因戒生定， 因定发慧， 就是说， 我们只要持戒力， 像在家人要持五戒， 不杀生， 不偷盗， 不邪淫， 不妄语， 不喝酒， 那这样的话呢， 你就持戒，持戒就会有定力了，有定力以后呢，这个智慧就会开启，所以呢，这就是一种修慧的方法。或是呢，要听经闻法，因为呢，我们不明白这个佛法，不明白真理，所以呢，需要有人来教导，那必须到道场呢来听经闻法。如果你听经了，那这个智慧就会开的，因为呢，这个经典呢，就是教我们真理，让我们呢返迷归觉。我们现在都迷了，但是我们听法就可以呢知道怎么在回去我们原来那种清净的自性里面去。因此呢，这个听经闻法是非常重要的。那么如果你听经闻法呢，你应该研究经典，因为研究经典呢深入经藏，智慧如海。这个佛讲的这种经藏呢，是佛的智慧，从佛的这种大智慧海里头流露出来的。所以如果我们去研究这个经藏的话，就表示呢我们是在研究佛的智慧。事实上佛的智慧跟我们本来智慧是一样的，就是说这个佛的智慧本来我们也有的，但是因为我们迷了，所以现在呢我们知道，我们不要只要把我们的贪嗔痴去除了，那我们自然就会有智慧。所以这个修行就是看起来很难，但是事实上的道理它是很简单，只是我们做的时候很不容易。因此呢，这个多听经多闻法是非常重要的。像各位呢，你可以在百忙中呢到道场来听法，这就是在修慧那你中午呢，你来供养这个食物的时候，就是在修福，所以这就是福慧双修了。
So how does one cultivate wisdom? In Buddhism, we hear the three non-outflow practices that are precepts, samadhi, and wisdom. For lay people, they uphold the five precepts, that of not killing, not stealing, not committing sexual misconduct, not lying, and no intoxicants. These five are the five precepts for lay people. And from holding these five precepts, one naturally develops samadhi, which then naturally develops wisdom. Another way to develop wisdom is to listen to the Buddha Dharma and to also listen to sutra lectures. Because here in the sutra lectures, we learn about true principles to live our lives by. And these true principles are something maybe we may not get in other places. They teach us how to return to our original self nature, our true nature. By investigating sutras, we can realize the Buddha's wisdom. We can tap into the Buddha's wisdom. His wisdom is like the sea, and it's basically the sutras are a manifestation of that wisdom. So for us, we want to be able to study the sutras and see our own, to look into our own minds and get out of our confusion. In fact, the Buddha's wisdom is the same as our wisdom. We have just gotten confused. If we could just get rid of the three poisons of greed, hatred, and delusion, then we can also realize our wisdom. In a way, you could say it's really simple in terms of the teachings. It's very straightforward. However, although it's seemingly simple, it's really not easy. For us to really cultivate and learn the Dharma, it takes a lot of work. So, it takes a lot of work.
Yeah. 当然，我们要修这个智慧修慧的法门很多的。像刚刚讲的，你呢这种持戒修定也可以开智慧，或是呢我们听经闻法也可以开智慧，研究经典也可以开智慧，或是呢你来礼拜经典也可以开智慧。像十法师呢，在1977年呢，他从洛杉矶金轮寺呢开始三步一拜，来朝拜万佛圣城。他身上呢就背了一部大方广佛华严经，然后每走三步他就一拜，他拜的时候就念着南无大方广佛华严经，华严海会佛菩萨，就这么辛苦的拜了2年9个月，然后就拜到万佛圣城。那你想想看，这如果对一般世俗的人来讲，他们会觉得这个人呢怎么这么愚痴这么做这么无聊的事情但是呢，事实上这是一个很殊胜的法门，因为这个法门呢可以开启智慧就是你在拜的时候呢可以 就啊，就是把我们的业障给消除了。同时呢，因为礼拜的是《大方广佛华严经》，是佛呢对着法身大士来讲的一部经典。这个经典的道理这么深，是菩萨的一个境界，所以能够礼拜这样的一部经典，当然他开启出来的智慧就可以跟菩萨是啊一样的，甚至将来呢，他也可以得到像诸佛菩萨的智慧。所以呢，拜经呢也是一个很好的一个修行的法门。
So I just said there's many ways to develop wisdom. I just gave two ways, such as cultivating precepts, samadhi, and wisdom, and listening to the Dharma, to listen to sutra lectures and Dharma talks. We can also investigate the sutras on our own, or we want to bow to the sutras. In 1977, Reverend Heng Sure went on a pilgrimage of bowing every three steps to the City of 10,000 Buddhas from L.A. He carried the Avatamsaka Sutra on his back, and for every three steps he took, he bowed down. And as he was bowing or walking, he would recite homage to the Flower Garland Sutra of Great Expanse of Teachings, and the ocean-wide Flower Garland 70 of Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. And so this hard work took him 2 years and 9 months before he arrived at the City of 10,000 Buddhas. So this really is a lot of work. However, those in the world looking at this, his actions, might think to themselves, wow, this is really foolish. This really does not make any sense. Why? This is so boring. What are you doing? Rather, this practice actually is very, very supreme and sublime. It really can open or develop our wisdom. It can lessen our karmic obstructions. Especially carrying the Avatamsaka Sutra and bowing the Avatamsaka Sutra, one plants this deep affinity with this profound text. One can really open to the wisdom that's contained in the Avatamsaka Sutra, and in the future become like the Bodhisattvas in the Avatamsaka Sutra as well. So it just takes time before that will happen. One is planting the seeds. So this is another way to realize wisdom, is to really bow to the sutras.
我上次到伯克莱的时候，有一个居士跟我讲说，他看过我写有一篇以前呢，我曾经拜经的经验，他希望我谈一谈，特别指定要有今天呢来谈谈这个事情。那我想也可以借刚好谈到这个智慧，那我就跟大家讲讲我的经验。那是在1995年的时候，那一年呢，我在台湾的六龟法界盛世，不过那个时候我还是一个在家人，那。因为呢，也去那边做义工，也是修福啊。那在那边的时候，因为那段时间呢，我是帮忙看庙而已啊，所以只有我一个人住在那边。那我住在那边的时候呢，刚好到那一年的六月，我们都知道上人呢圆寂了，1995年啊，那个农历的5月8号啊，5月10号上人圆寂了。那么上人圆寂了以后呢，我自己就有一点觉得说呢，因为我能够学佛，我能够明白这么多道理，都是因为上人这位大善知识的引导，所以我才能够明白佛法。那因此呢，当时我就想，我接触的第一部经典就是上人所讲解的《妙法莲华经》浅释，因此呢，那时候我就想动了一个念头，我想要礼拜一部《妙法莲华经》来就是回报上人。因此呢，我就开始来拜经。那这个拜经就是一个字一拜的每拜一个字，一个字就一拜，一个字给一拜。那因为那时候是六月份，六月份的时候呢算天气蛮热了，因为已经是夏天了，所以呢，我就选择在早上，每天呢早上5点钟做完早课了，那我就到楼下楼下比较凉快一点，那就到楼下呢来拜经。那一开始很辛苦啊，因为你知道拜的时候当然也会累啊，会腿酸啊，而且呢，因为天气热嘛，虽然是早上5点多钟啊，可是很热，所以呢。全身都是大汗就是拜经的时候呢，这个身衣物都湿掉了。 不过呢拜得很法喜、啊、虽然很辛苦呢越拜呢越欢喜、啊、越拜呢那个精神体力就越好、啊、越容易拜，拜了以后呢也不累了。所以呢 那段那个经验是对我来讲是毕生难忘的，因为有时候呢你要特别挑时间，然后有这么清静的环境来拜一部经是很不容易的。那时候呢我拜经也发生了一个很特别很特殊的事情，也许我不晓得有没有人听过啊，不过呢我可以重述一次。因为在六归法界圣师啊，他是在山上，那在那边很多山的，我们的庙呢就在半山腰，这个半山腰的建筑里面呢，其实这座道场呢以前是啊、一个现在在台湾的一个、啊、很大的官、啊、他的家族的一个别墅，他们供养给上人的。那么 这座建筑呢供养给上人的时候呢，那时候第一个去接收这个建筑的就是司法师、啊、所以他是第一个去看这个道场的人。那司法师就很清楚、啊、这个六归法界圣师里头呢有一个特殊的、啊、东西，就是蛇、啊、这个里面呢很多蛇，一开始的时候好多蛇的，我去的时候也有，但是不是那么多了，不过还是大概两天三天就会看到一次的，尤其早上起来做早课，那这个时候呢都是他们晚上会出来的。那时候我在、啊、拜经的时候呢，当然那个早上五点钟啊，那个有时候 天就快要亮了，还没有亮，那在楼下呢那个地板呢都是黑色的那种大理石、啊、那个石头 的地板、啊、而且呢那个不是看得很清楚、啊、那个地板上还有很多白色的花纹，所以呢我走路的时候要特别小心，为什么？因为就怕踩到蛇嘛，所以要看着地上走路。那我每天呢、就到楼下要拜经的时候呢，我当然也会看看这个楼下呢、有没有蛇啊，不要去踩到他们。有一天呢我就准备要拜经了，那就下楼以后呢、我看一看、什么都没有、所以呢我就去上香。我上香了以后呢、我拜经、我描述一下你会比较清楚啊，就发生了什么状况。我拜经的经本的那个法华经呢就放在一个粥上，这个粥子呢就像我们中午在吃饭很长长的那个粥子啊，然后就把那个法华经呢放在上面。那我用一个榻榻米的拜垫啊，那个榻榻米呢就不是像我们现在你们拜的这么高，就是那个日本人用那个榻榻米的那种拜垫，就这样拜，那个拜起来是比较辛苦的。那个楼下的那个有一个佛像，释迦牟尼佛的佛像，那我就去上香。这个佛像离我拜经的地方大概就是十步、啊、就是可能不到五公尺吧、啊、就短短的距离，所以我就去上香。等到我去上完香回来的时候呢、啊、我的拜殿呢、啊、就有一条蛇、啊、有一条蛇呢它就盘踞在那边。那我当时呢就很奇怪、啊、因为刚刚我怎么看都没有蛇啊，怎么我只是去上个香，这个中间呢连一分钟都不到，怎么就有一条蛇 啊就在拜殿上呢？那我就站到后那个拜殿的后面，我要看看呢他到底在拜殿上要干什么。结果呢我就站在他的后面，那过一下子呢这条蛇呢他就用他很快的速度，动作很快，哇，很敏捷的。然后他怎么样呢？他就很快的爬到那个我刚刚讲那个舟子，那个舟子就是长长的舟子，他的脚呢是细细的啊，有四个脚。那个蛇呢就很快的啊，顺着一只那个舟子的脚呢爬上去。可是呢，他没有真正的爬到舟子上去，他就爬了大概三分之二。然后呢又像一个很顽皮的小孩子，又让他滑下来，就是他爬上去呢他不继续爬，他就让他自己滑下来。那滑下来以后呢他又爬上去，然后又让他滑下来，就像在那边玩一下、啊、就在玩。那总共几次，就是爬了三次。 这爬上三次呢，他都没有爬上去啊。然后呢，他又 爬回到这个拜殿啊，就又回到拜殿。那你这个你就要自己要去议会啦，好像呢，那个因为那个桌子上有一部《法华经》啊，所以他就爬了三次，好像呢在顶礼《法华经》一样。我是自己这样想的啊，就是说他好像呢很兴奋，因为可以看到《法华经》啊，就往上爬，往上爬，然后就又很顽皮的让他滑下来。可是呢，他又回到这个拜殿上去。那我不晓得他到底又要做什么，所以我还是站在他的后面，离了大概三尺左右。结果呢，他又回过头来，哎，他好像知道后面有人了，就怎么样，又爬离开那个拜殿，然后爬离开了拜殿，然后他那个头呢，啊，那个蛇的身体，那个头就昂起来，然后呢，很快的就冲到我的面前，就是用很快的速度爬到我的面前，然后他没有继续爬，就停下来，那个蛇头呢就抬得高高的，就看着我，然后我也看着他。是蛇跟人就对望，结果呢，哎，大概过了可能20秒吧，他看完了呢，哎，就也没有怎么样，又回过头去了，他又爬啊，转身爬回去了，然后就不回到拜殿了，就离开了，就是从那个房子的边边走了。这是我在拜法华经的时候一个很特殊的一个啊。那种经验，因为这个实在 太特别了，就是怎么蛇呢它会在、就是有这样的一个情形发生。我也不晓得它在做什么，因为呢它看到法华经的时候好像很兴奋很兴奋，就像一个哦，那个真的很难描述啊。当然因为 我用讲的时候呢，你就知道说那个就像一个很顽皮的小孩啊，他就在那边爬，然后爬了又让他掉下来，爬了掉下来。那我以前也讲过啊，此法是因为他在那边有经验，所以他呢知道有人去六龟，他就问说：“哎，蛇有没有来听经啊？”啊，那个六龟的蛇是很有灵性的。那我自己是啊，有好几次跟这些蛇呢有很特别的那种相处的经验。那这是其中之一。那另外一个经验，以前我也讲过，就是在诵《华严经》的时候呢，有一条蛇啊，它真的是来听经的。
So, so.In terms of bowing to the sutras, a layperson asked me to share some of my own experiences bowing to the sutra. Because I bowed to one of the Lotus Sutra in 1995. So this time I was still a layman in Taiwan. And I was at the Liu Gui Monastery I was the only one there. I was kind of taking care of the monastery. I was the only layman there, volunteering and taking care of the temple. So you can say this is a way to cultivate blessings. Now, as I was taking care of the monastery at that time, in the sixth lunar month, people know that the Venerable Master passed away, or maybe it's June. But it's the fifth lunar month, the 10th day. And so the Venerable Master basically entered nirvana. And so at that time, I thought to myself, for me to learn the Buddhism, it really came through the Venerable Master. He was a good and wise advisor to lead me. What can I do? So I thought to myself, maybe I can bow to the Lotus Sutra as a way to repay his kindness. This was done by doing every character in the sutra, I would bow one time. So that time, in the middle of the sixth month, it was quite hot. And so I would bow in the morning, starting at 5 a.m., and do belly the bowing in the morning. So this was actually a lot of hard work, as people who bowed before know, that I became very tired, my legs ached, you know, I'd endure the hot and cold, and always I'd be completely covered with sweat. However, I was also filled with Dharma joy. And although my clothes were soaked with sweat, I often feel like I had more and more energy. This kind of experience is really hard to forget. It was something that was very wonderful and pure, and it gave me an opportunity to really, really cultivate. this is a rare opportunity because most people, we don't have that kind of opportunity to be in a pure way place and not with a lot of responsibility, so we can focus on our practice. So people who know, Liu Gui Monastery is out on the mountains, and it was an offering by someone to the Venerable Master. And so, as people might know, Liu Gui Monastery was first received by Reverend Heng Sure in terms of taking care of the campus. And so he would take care of the monastery, and he made a comment to me saying, do the snakes come to listen to the sutra? And that's because in the monastery there, the snakes are very active. They actually, for myself, when I was there, the snakes have already decreased in number. So only about maybe every 2 or 3 days I see one snake. This would oftentimes happen in the morning ceremony because it was still dark and they were crawling around at night. So they might be out on the middle of the floor. So I had to be careful not to step on them. So I would often pay close attention to the floors to make sure I don't step on a snake. And then one time before I was getting ready to bow to the sutras, I saw that at that time what I had was I had a little, I had put a long table, kind of like we had in the dining hall, and load a sutra on it. And then I'll have a bowing cushion in front. And then I would bow to the sutra. And the bowing cushion actually was just a tatami. It wasn't like the higher bowing cushion we have here, it's a tatami. So that bowing on that actually is a lot more work. So I would go into the Buddha image in front and light some incense and then come back to my space. So in this period of time, which is a very brief moment of going to light the incense, when I came back, I saw there was a snake on the middle of the cushion. And so I was quite surprised because I didn't even go out more than a minute to light the incense. And here was a snake at the place where I was going to bow. So I looked at the snake, and the snake also kind of looked at me and was just sitting there. And I thought, what to do? I just kind of watched the snake. And the snake then went toward the table to the Lotus Sutra and started crawling up the legs of the table up to the top. Kind of very playfully, I thought. He would crawl up to the top, and all of a sudden, he would slide down the leg. Then he would crawl back up again and slide down. Then maybe three times. So I thought he was just playing around. Or maybe he was bowing to the sutra. So I thought, okay, that's very interesting. So then he came back to the bowing cushion and just stayed there. And I thought to myself, okay. So I was just still watching him. And he basically looked at me, and I looked at him. And we looked at each other for a while. And then he left the bowing cushion and kind of left from the corner of the room. And so that was quite interesting to me. And so I don't know what to say about that experience. Although I could say my feeling was that he looked like he was very excited and very happy to be able to be so close to the Lotus Sutra. It seemed like something that he was very joyful about. So here in Liu Gui, you can say even the snakes come to listen to or draw near the Dharma.
讲到这个六龟呢，我可以顺便讲一个经验好了，因为我在1992年呢，曾经到过万佛圣城住了五个月，那个时候呢。 上人呢，大概一个礼拜、两个礼拜也会回到圣城。那我去圣城的时候呢，是第一次去的。那我对圣城完全不熟悉，我也没有从来没有见过上人。去的时候才知道上人是长个什么样子。那我去的时候带了一个新的照相机，我本来想好好去拍一拍圣城。 后来我到圣城以后，发现我什么都不需要了，连一张相片都是多余的，所以呢，我带着照相机，连一张照片都没有拍。那个时候呢，其实上人也常常会出来的，可是事实上我也没有，从来没有跟上人讲过任何一句话。不过呢，有机会呢，会站在上人的旁边，或是听听呢上人对别人 讲的开示。等到1995年，我在六龟的时候呢，那时候上人圆寂了。 在圆寂的时候呢，我心里就有一点后悔了。那时候我在六龟嘛，刚刚讲那个拜金的时候，就是我在那边，我心里就真的有一点后悔。我说：“哎呀，以后呢，我再见不到上人了。”那以前呢，这个三年前，我有机会在万佛圣城，然后常常可以看到上人。那时候我有一台照相机啊，我为什么当时那么笨啊，不跟上人照张照片呢？那现在呢，不会再有这样的机会了。你想想看，那时候很愚痴啊，居然会想到说，以后呢，如果我想看到上人，或是也许呢，我有一张照片的时候，我就会感觉跟上人在一起这样的一个感觉。那事实上不可能，因为我从来没有跟上人照过照片啊，我也在万佛圣城自己也没有照过任何一张照片。可是很奇妙的事情就发生了，在就是上人圆寂大概过了四个月，那个时候呢，在台湾的道场，他们就做了一本那个纪念册，小小的，那是在台湾特别做的，那当然是完全是用中文的。那个里面呢有很多有关上人的介绍，还有上人的照片。那我就收到这样的一本小小的纪念册，我就翻着看，翻着看，我一翻呢，觉得好奇怪啊！哎，怎么这个照片有一个人很像我呢？而且是站在上人的后面，我自己越看越不相信，因为那时候1992年的时候，我变得很瘦，所以呢，有一点认不出自己。但是那个人明明是我啊，而且那衣服都是的。后来我确定是我啊，我就奇怪，怎么会有这一张照片呢？我而且还站在上人的后面。那地点在哪里？就在万佛圣城的庙宇堂，因为呢，上人回去的时候呢，他会教对联，那时候我会去上人的这个对联课。那上人的对联课呢，他上人把这个对联上联呢写在那个板子上，然后他就坐下来，坐在那边，每个人呢都可以上台去写你的下联。所以呢，我几乎每次呢也会去写下联。那张照片就是这么巧，有人拍了照片，那刚好就是上人坐在那边，我就站在上人的身后在写对联，所以呢，那个照片拍得很清楚啊，我的脸啊，或是上人在微笑啊，那个距离很近，这个距离大概两三尺而已，就是这么近。你想想看，打了一个妄想说，这一辈子呢，好像没有那样的一个机会可以呢，跟上人在一起了。可是呢，即使上人圆寂了，他都还可以满我的愿，那个照片上都还有日期啊，所以呢，这是很不可思议的。因为这个有时候，我想这个不是要大家打妄想，我只是说，因为有时候住道场啊，那你随便打妄想，其实都是很灵的。包括怎么讲呢？我刚刚讲到那个蛇啊，有一次呢，已经是冬天了，那冬天刚完了，就春天，就三月份的时候，其实气候还很冷啊，照道理呢，还没有蛇。那个时候呢，有一个晚上，就是有些法师呢要去做法会，所以有居士跟着去。就有一个小孩子呢，他知道六龟的蛇是很出名的。那个小孩子大概是五六岁吧，他呢一进门呢，什么话都不讲，他就问说：“蛇在哪里？蛇在哪里？”然后就问这样的话。那我就跟他回说：“哦，现在没有蛇啊，现在是天气很冷，冬天呢、蛇都在睡觉，没有蛇啊。”那我就去做别的事，因为明天要有法会。那这个小孩子他不死心的，他就一直在问别人蛇在哪里，蛇在哪里。我在别的房间都还听他在讲说蛇在哪里。然后他们很多人呢就准备在一个很大的房间，因为有几个居士去了，他们就准备在那个楼下的一个房间睡觉。那所以他们就在房间里有几个人在里面，那个小孩子还在那边问蛇在哪里。我就在隔壁的房间，突然我就听到哇，好大的一个声音啊！他们那个房间的人全部跑出来了。为什么呢？因为我就问一个法师，到底发生什么事情啊？为什么大家喊得那么大声呢？那个法师说，真的有一条蛇从床底下爬出来了。然后呢，你看给这个小孩子满了愿。这个小孩子呢，想到道场看条蛇呢，居然呢那个蛇都从床底下呢跑出来了。我讲这个只是说，有时候呢，这个我们的道场里头就是如果你好好来护持的时候呢， 但是不要乱打妄想啊，不要打说我要怎么样怎么样，因为有时候打得太灵了啊，因为这些只是我只是啊，因为想到六规呢，顺便跟大家讲一讲，其实也没有什么特别意义，那也不希望呢大家说因为听了这个故事有什么妄想，最好呢你在这个道场的时候呢你修福啊，那也修慧，那你修福的时候不要执着你在修福了，就像我刚刚讲那个居士，他在万佛圣城护持道场，那他就努力的做工嘛，努力 来做他的事情，以后呢他的钱的问题自然就解决了，所以呢不要去打妄想呢，就这个是最清净也是最究竟的修行。
So, when I was talking about the monastery, the Liu Gui, I was in the City of 10,000 Buddhas in 1992 for 5 months. And at that time, the Venerable Master was still in the world. And I remember that he actually came to the City of 10,000 Buddhas once for 1 or 2 days every week. And this was my first time at the City of 10,000 Buddhas, so I had no experience living there. But I would see the Venerable Master, and at that time, I was still new there, so I actually bought a new camera. I thought to myself, I'm going to take some pictures of the monastery and also and just to get a sense of the surroundings. But once I got there, I realized just even saying a couple of words was unneeded, was extraneous, was superfluous. So I didn't even use my camera at all. I did not take one picture when I was there. The Venerable Master would come out, and I actually never spoke to the Venerable Master at all. I sometimes would be next to the Venerable Master, but I never spoke to him. And so in 1995, when the Venerable Master entered Nirvana, I was at Liu Gui Monastery. And in my heart, I actually felt a little bit of regret. Because I thought to myself, I could not see the Venerable Master again. But 3 years ago, I had an opportunity to be next to him. And at that time, I actually had a camera. I could have taken a picture of the Venerable Master, maybe I've taken a picture with him. But I was so stupid, I didn't take any picture. So at that time, you can see how foolish I was. I thought maybe having a picture of me and the Venerable Master together might give me a sense that, you know, that somehow encouraged me a little bit, that I was helped me remember the Venerable Master. So, however, 4 months later, when I was in Taiwan, the Taiwan actually 4 months after the Venerable Master entered Nirvana, they published a little booklet that was in remembrance of the Venerable Master. In it, it was all in Chinese. They introduced Master Hua and also had pictures of him as well. And it has some small, small things in it. So as I looked through the book, I took a look at the pictures and I saw one picture, and the person behind the Venerable Master in the picture looked quite a bit like me. The person was quite thin, though, because I think at that time I was much thinner. But I looked at it and I said, yeah, it's me. The clothing's the same, it's right at the right time. And I had no idea where the picture came from or who took the picture. But it was actually in the Wonderful Words Hall in the City of 10,000 Buddhas. And it was wearing the matching couplet class that the Venerable Master was conducting. What he would do is he would write up a couplet, a verse for a couplet, the first verse. And then all the students would go up and try to write the second verse. So I would always try to write a second verse to match the couplet, to finish the couplet. And so at that time, somebody had taken a picture when I was behind the Venerable Master. And I could see we were very close. We were just a couple feet apart. And you could see the smile on his face. And I was very clear in the background as well, on my face, etc. And so you can see it was just an interesting moment. Although after the Venerable Master already entered Nirvana, I just had a false thought, hoping to have a picture, and this picture arrived. So you can see how, you can see, living in a monastery with a false thought, how efficacious the false thought is. You know, it immediately kind of comes to fruition. So this, also for another story, I remember in the third month, oftentimes there's no snakes because it's much colder, so there aren't that many snakes around. So one time there was this child who came, this little young boy, who was maybe 5 or 6 years old. And that time he heard that there were snakes in Liugui Monastery. And so he kept asking, where are the snakes? Where are the snakes? At that time, it was the day before a large Dharma assembly at the monastery, so I was busy preparing everything. So I said, you know, there isn't actually any snakes at this time. They're all sleeping. It's too cold. And so I wanted to do some work. But the kid was unstoppable. He just kept asking, where's the snakes? Where's the snakes? I want to see the snakes. Where's the snake? So he kept talking all day long, asking, where's the snakes? Where's the snakes? At that time, all laymen lived in a big room together. And so they were sleeping in the room. And all of a sudden, I heard a kind of a shout. And all of them come running outside. And I said, what's going on? And I asked somebody, and they said, oh, because when they were there, a snake had crawled out from under the bed. So they all ran away. So the child got to realize his wish to see a snake. So you could say, you know, that having all this, I'm not trying to encourage people to have false thinking in the monastery. That's not the point. It's just, you have to be very careful when you're having a lot of false thoughts in a monastery, because they're just really too efficacious. You want to really be mindful and not have a lot of false thinking. But still, if you really want to cultivate, you want the best is to cultivate blessings and wisdoms and not get attached. Like I told the story of the layman before who is working in the city of the 1,000 Buddhas, and he just works in the monastery, helps out, and doesn't have any expectations. And so when it really comes down to it, his children's financial needs get taken care of and things go smoothly.
今天晚上时间到了，那主要呢就是讲怎么修福，怎么修慧。所以呢，我希望呢大家在这个道场来听经文法以后呢，都能够啊福慧双足，将来跟佛一样，成为两足尊。
So now time's up. So tonight we mostly spoke about blessings and wisdom and how to cultivate blessings and wisdom. And so I wish all of you tonight that you can be perfect in blessings and wisdom and be just like the Buddha, who is the doubly perfected one. Amitofo. So we'll do the transference. Okay, let's maybe first announcements. I believe to any announcements coming up? Yomisama. Okay, so we have a class on April 27th, is a Sunday. I believe Dharma Master Zhuang will be coming at 3:30, and she'll be speaking on the Theravada text, well, a kind of a Mahayana perspective on the Theravada text. So that'll be here at 3:30 in the Buddha Hall. In fact, there'll also be an Ahimsa event at the same time in this Buddha Hall on near-death experiences. So if people are interested in near-death experiences, at 1 o'clock, I believe, it'll start. They'll have an event here in the Buddha Hall here. Yes, Jarma Shang will be speaking in the dining hall, and the event for the Ahimsa will be in the Buddha Hall. I believe she's also going to be leading the lecture on next week, Saturday night. So if people have the time, she's a very good Dharma speaker, and she's only here for a brief period of time and from her trip from Taiwan. So if people have an opportunity, she has a lot of knowledge of the sutras. Anything else? Okay. So your transference of merit is in the back of your request for Dharma sheet. So if you have anywhere you would like to wish this merit would go out to, please make your wish now. May every living being, our minds as one and radiant with light, share the fruits of peace, with hearts of goodness luminous and bright. If people hear and see how hands and hearts can find in giving unity, may their minds awake to great compassion, wisdom, and to joy. May kindness find reward. May all who sorrow leave their grief and pain. May this boundless light break the darkness of their endless night. Because our hearts are one, this world of pain turns into paradise. May all become compassionate and wise. May all become compassionate and wise.
So please stand and we'll bow to the Buddhas.